Okay, good afternoon. So this is the 15th amendment panel. I think we're going to bring together hopefully a lot of things we've already heard. I want to start by introducing our panel. So we have Pamela Brandwine, who's professor of American politics, law, courts, and politics at University of Michigan. David Romine, who is a doctoral candidate at Duke. Kalila Brown Dean, who's associate professor of political science at Quinnipiac College of Arts and Sciences. Ismael White, who's an associate professor of political science at George Washington University. And James Galbraith, who is the Lloyd M. Benson Chair of Government and Business Relations and professor of government at the University of Texas at Austin. I think we have the benefit of having had the opportunity to listen to a lot of the other groups. And one of the things that's occurred to me is that we've heard a lot about myths and tropes. Myths I think of as the sort of grounding stories that we tell ourselves as about what we aspire to be, and tropes are how we describe those who we consider outside so we can justify why they are not sort of given the same full rights. And I think what we're dealing with as we look at the Reconstruction Amendments is what is necessary for full citizenship. So is it enough not to be enslaved, which is what we looked at when we talked about the 13th Amendment? Is citizenship in name enough, which is what we talked about when we looked at the 14th Amendment? Or is it to be able to participate more fully in democracy, which I think is what we're trying to capture with the 15th Amendment? But I think as we look to understand the 15th Amendment, we're seeing the same myths, right, which is that we are a democratic society, and we see the same tropes, but these others are outsiders, and that is why they are not allowed to participate fully. That's why they are not allowed to vote. So what we're going to start with is looking at what's the role of the federal government, or what has been the role of the federal government and really enforcing the 15th Amendment. And this has happened at different points historically. We're going to start with what that looks like in Reconstruction, and Professor Brandwine is going to sort of take us through some of her work and how it sort of clarifies what that looks like.
Thanks, Malik. It's a real pleasure to be here, and I'm going to try to be real brief because we got a lot of smart and interesting people here and not a lot of time. And so the myth actually that I want to talk very briefly about is this particular kind of myth about the legal and political history about the unraveling of Reconstruction. And this isn't one of these aspirational myths that make us think, oh, things are really better than they actually are. This is a myth that the historian C. Van Woodward referred to in the 1950s as the Compromise of 1877. And this story that C. Van Woodward told, and that historians and law professors and political scientists, folks across the disciplines, have been really adhering to for quite some time, is that the Republican Party, who gave us Reconstruction, and who also, by the way, gave us the dispossession of native lands in the West, it's very important to see that these centrist Republicans who gave us Reconstruction also gave us conceptions of property and contract that were used to dispossess natives of their land in the West. The Republican Party, the story of the Compromise of 1877 is that the Republicans ran into a problem with the disputed election of 1876, and that the Republicans and the Democrats made a deal in the wake of this disputed election. And according to this story, the Republicans gave up efforts to enforce black rights in the South in exchange for control of the national economic policy. And so the story is that this Compromise of 1877 was the end of Reconstruction and was the end of the Republican Party's commitment to black rights, and in particular black voting rights. And so this, in fact, turns out to be a myth. A historian named Morgan Kouser was arguing this as early as 1974 in a book called The Shaping of Southern Politics. He talked about how black voting continued. But Kouser was really an outlier in the 1970s. And it's only been much more recently, the last 10 years or so, that we now have more empirical evidence that shows, in fact, that the Republican Party maintained a principal commitment to black voting in the 1870s, and that in the early 1880s, the enforcement of black voting rights in the South upticked. Starting in 1880 to 1885, this was the regime of President James Garfield, a moderate Republican, and his vice president, Chester Arthur, after Garfield was assassinated. And this upturn in voting rights enforcement in the 1880s looks like a puzzle. It's like, well, why would the Republicans do this if supposedly they had abandoned black rights? And then what would be the constitutional authority? What would be the theory of voting rights by which they could actually protect, to some degree, black voting rights in the South? And so in some of my past prior work, I've gone back and looked at some key Reconstruction era voting rights decisions. And what I found is that folks today have actually misunderstood the theory of voting rights that the Supreme Court actually articulated in some very famous cases. One of them is called United States versus Cruikshank, which is actually known for setting Klansmen free after one of the worst massacres of Reconstruction. But there are a number of other cases that people don't know about and we don't hear about when we learn about the history of the 15th Amendment. And one of these cases is called Ex parte Yarbrough. It's an 1884 case, and for those of you who know your state action doctrine, there's a very, very famous case in 1883 where the Supreme Court basically said black people don't have equal rights to public accommodations, and the court issued some very racist statements in that case. And yet the very next year, a unanimous court sends Klansmen to jail under, in part, the 15th Amendment, and they give us a theory of voting rights that the Garfield and Arthur administrations had been using in the South to revitalize voting rights. And so the theory of voting rights that was used, just to give you a flavor of this, because this is part of the story about what it would mean to revitalize the 15th Amendment today, and something called federal elections law. In the 19th century, we had what was called a hybrid constitution. The constitution was seen to protect natural rights that the constitution declared or secured. But there were these other kinds of rights that were seen to be created. And the constitution itself was seen as the source of these rights. And so this actually gives us a very robust theory of voting rights, where federalism actually is not a principle for the court when it comes to voting rights. You don't have to wait for state action. You don't even have to wait for state failure to enforce voting rights laws. All you needed was an indictment that said somebody had a race-based motive to interfere with voting rights under state law, or you needed to show that somebody was interfering in a federal election under Article 1, Section 4. And so we have lost in our constitutional history and in our political history an understanding of both this voting rights theory and case law that was accepted and cited by the Supreme Court through the end of the 19th century. This case law was basically erased at the turn of the 20th century, and so part of what we could do, certainly, is resuscitate these old cases. And so there's actually very good, solid doctrinal support for a very robust voting rights theory that's actually disconnected from state action doctrine and disconnected from high proof thresholds. And so it was used in the 1870s, it was used in the 1880s, and I'll just stop there as a way of providing some background that sort of turns some conventional knowledge on its head, because the conventional knowledge is that this Reconstruction era case law is actually not just neutral but negative, that it's actually an impediment to the enforcement of voting rights. And I believe that it's actually not.
Which provides for us to sort of look to actually expand when Reconstruction begins and ends. But a lot of the work, and we've heard about communities and allies and how these things work, and as we've moved into the 20th century, a lot of you guys have seen Selma and these other stories, and we're interested in how communities have attempted to use the 15th Amendment, whether it's in small communities or on a larger scale, and Mr. Romain is going to sort of talk about his research and how it fits with that.
Thank you, Malik, and thank you, everyone else. So I wanted to start out, you know, if we're talking about myths, I think one of the most important myths that we have today is this idea of the civil rights movement as this bookended, as this event, set of series of events that are bookended, 1954 with the Brown decision, 1965 with the Voting Rights Act. And I think what's really interesting is that when we dig into this, as Aaron Colson and I have done in the SNCC Legacy Project, a partnership with Duke Rubenstein Library, is when you start actually digging into these stories, you find out that these communities in which the volunteers and the secretaries of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee went into, they found people already organized. They found people already articulating their rights. And they found a long history of organizing. And so I would say, you know, the myth that I'm trying to question or perhaps destroy is this idea that, that things start in 1954. And I think a lot of you who are familiar with the literature are familiar with the ways in which that periodization has been sort of an ever-changing series of dates over the last few years. But what I'm saying is what I'm arguing is that if you start at the Second World War, things become a lot clearer. And this picture takes a very different shape. And so, you know, one of the most interesting things about the Second World War is the way in which African-American men, primarily, were drafted and sent all around the world to fight for freedom and democracy. And, you know, one of those was a man named Amzie Moore, who was born in 1911 in a small town in southwestern Mississippi. And when he got back, he reflected that, and this is a quote, "I think what God did with me was put me on a ship and send me around the world and let me live in different environments and be in contact with different people and truly find out what was behind it, because I certainly didn't know." And what he was speaking about was white supremacy. And what he encountered as he traveled through Europe was white people who didn't have the same outward racial values and practices of racism that he was familiar with. And he also came in contact with African soldiers, Indian soldiers, Burmese soldiers, soldiers from throughout, you know, the colonial empires of the world. So when he returned back to Mississippi, he started recognizing that the 15th Amendment actually applied to him, and the 14th Amendment, the 13th, all these amendments that he had, you know, become aware of, all of a sudden he realized that they applied to him, and he started organizing to make that a reality. And he was joined in his effort by others, including C.C. Bryant, including Aaron Henry, all of whom who had served abroad, all of whom came back to Mississippi, all of whom recognized that their rights were, they were entitled to these rights, but they had to fight for them. And they did, and they began organizing. You know, one of the most famous figures of the civil rights movement, whose quote has been behind us several times, is Miss Ella Baker. And during this time period, in the late 40s and the early 50s, Miss Baker was a secretary of the NAACP and went on oftentimes clandestine missions throughout Mississippi and Arkansas and Alabama to these small chapters of the NAACP as they were organizing specifically around the right to register to vote. Another site of organizing was Mound Bayou, which had the inestimable T.R.M. Howard and his red Cadillac and the Regional Council of Negro Leadership. And the RCNL was registering black voters in the late 40s, early 50s, up to 17,000 at one point, giving us a sense of what was possible and what was going on, so that when Robert Moses arrives in Mississippi in 1960, after the conference at Shaw University, after the formation of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, he meets Amzie Moore, and Amzie Moore says, "Well, when are we going to get started on this voting rights project?" So one of the myths that the SNCC Legacy Project and the SNCC Digital Gateway in particular are trying to correct for is this idea that these outside, well-meaning, well-intentioned college students who were caught up in the energy of the sit-in movement came to these local communities and said, "We're going to talk about voting rights." And what instead we're finding when we talk to the veterans of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and we talk to the local folks who they worked with, was that when they arrived, it was the Amzie Moores and the C.C. Bryants and the Aaron Henrys who said, "This is what we'd like to do." And it was they who pushed Bob Moses to begin the Voting Rights Project and to see and really to understand voting rights as a form of direct action. And if those of you who are familiar with some of the debates that went on at that first SNCC conference will recall, the big debate was between, well, should we do direct action, which was understood as sit-ins, or should we do voting rights? And it was the local Mississippi folks, these veterans of the Second World War, these men who had seen the world, who came to see voting rights as indivisible from direct action. It was a form of direct action. And that movement after 1954 took on a whole new shape because of the violence directed against it, because of the fallout from the Brown situation, and got us to where we were familiar, all familiar territory in 1960. So, and I'll just wrap it up there and hand it back over to Malik.
Okay. And I think this has laid the groundwork, looking at sort of the 15th Amendment initially as giving this guarantee of the right to vote. The second part of the 15th Amendment allows Congress to pass laws in support of this. Now, Congress took a while to get around to doing this. And so we end up with the Voting Rights Act. And if you guys have been paying attention, you know there's the back and forth. So we've had Shelby County versus Holder. But both Professor Brown Dean and White have captured, have written on the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act. And so I've got two different, I guess, questions for them. One, Professor White, to sort of look at from a historical perspective how it works. But then how do we use the 15th Amendment with the limitations that the court has placed post the Shelby County decision?
So did you want me to go first, or do you want him
you
to talk the historical piece? Okay. So good afternoon, and thank you for having us here. And as you heard, Professor White and I co-authored a piece for the Joint Center called 50 Years of the Voting Rights Act. And we wanted to ask this very simple question. What did the act actually do? So there was a lot of conversation about Shelby, about what it actually meant. Did it get rid of the Voting Rights Act, or did it simply gut it? And we wanted to start with this very simple premise. One of the greatest myths is that the 15th Amendment created an affirmative right to vote. And we've seen time and again that, in fact, it did not, which made the VRA necessary to begin with. But we wanted to know, what has the impact been? So Professor White will talk more about the registration piece. But what we saw was that on every indicator, registration, voter turnout, office holding, the Voting Rights Act made a difference. That African Americans had more significant gains than other groups. However, it did increase the political profile of the Latinx community, of Native American communities, and also of Asian American communities. But what we also found, again to this idea of myths, is that although those gains had been made, all of those groups still lag far behind. And we asked a question that was somewhat different from other reports. We wanted to know, what difference does it make? So that if you now have over 10,000 black elected officials, what are black communities getting in return for their support and for their level of party loyalty? And we found that on every indicator across all of these racial and ethnic groups, black voters receive less in terms of policy responsiveness than any other group. And it also showed us, particularly in local elections, that race remains the dividing factor when it comes to vote choice. It's not partisanship, it's not class, it's not urbanicity, it's race. And so thinking about now post-Shelby, why this is even more important, two key points. One, it shows that the rules of the game matter. So that if you have a Supreme Court saying, you can go ahead and make whatever laws you want to until Congress can decide on a new formula, you have a state like Texas enacting new rules within hours. So we talk about government, right? Everybody hates government until they need government. And as someone who just went through the Northeastern blizzard 2 days ago, I understand that love-hate relationship. Government is notoriously slow, but on the issue of new voting restrictions, worked within hours. So it meant that in 2016, in the primaries, voters in Nevada had to wait 3 to 4 hours because polling places had been moved or reduced. And that has an impact on the quality of democracy for every person within that county and within that district. It meant that last week, during LA's municipal elections, people who had been voting for 10 years showed up at the polling place and the polling place wasn't there, or were told that their names had been kicked off of the rolls. So that's why those rules are so important and necessitate this look at, what does the 15th actually say? What did Shelby do? And more importantly, what can voters do now? And the second key takeaway then is that the past is prologue. So last week I interviewed a woman whose mother, her mother's name was Maggie Bozeman, was arrested in Pickens County, Alabama in 1979. So there was an article from Ebony Magazine that said, Pickens is the county where racism refuses to die. And in 1979, her mother was arrested, charged with 5 felony counts for helping illiterate voters in Pickens County register and get to the polls, even though the Voting Rights Act of 1965, the 1972 amendment said that language should not be a barrier to voting. So she was operating within the boundaries of what the Voting Rights Act said, but was still charged with 4 felonies. She was convicted. She was sentenced to 10 years in prison because of local activists connecting with national activists. That prison sentence was reduced, so she served 10 months in a women's workhouse. But here's the key point. 1979, Maggie Bozeman lost her ability to vote for the rest of her life. So this is where, when we think about now, post-Shelby, this is where the 13th, the 14th, and the 15th really come together. 1 in 7 African Americans in the state of Alabama has permanently lost their ability to vote because of a past conviction. So if we look at voter disenfranchisement related to mass incarceration, the fact that there are over 5 million Americans barred from voting because of a past conviction, the question becomes, are the challenges we're now facing, do they align with the motivation behind the Voting Rights Act of 1965? Is there a way to think about representation more broadly? And it's particularly important as we come toward the 2020 census, because that's when districts will be reshaped and redrawn based on those census counts. So if you have a state like Pennsylvania, which has a very high inmate population, and those inmates are counted within districts as if they were full citizens, then that means certain counties get different representation. And that's why I think post-Shelby, it's not just about the photo ID, which is very important, but it's also those ways that seem racially neutral or facially neutral that bring up many of those long-standing questions about, do black votes matter? Do voters of color matter? And how can we shape the process to benefit certain people? Thank you.
Thank you, Kalila. I'm a co-author, as Kalila mentioned, I'm a co-author of this Joint Center report on Voting Rights Act. I'm also the director of survey research at the Joint Center. And so what I'm gonna talk to you about is just briefly about the sort of dynamics of black voter registration beginning with Reconstruction. So as part of this report and as part of my work with the Joint Center, we've been putting together a database of black voter registration over time and beginning with the beginning with Reconstruction and to today. And so we've completed the first state, which is Louisiana. They tend to have the best records for reasons I can't figure out. This is my home state, so that's part of why it was the first state. But and so we have black voter, we have a database of black voter registration by parish in the state of Louisiana from 1878 to 2010. As far as I know, it's the first of its kind to cover that entire time period. And so with this database, one of the goals is to try to understand these sort of ebbs and flows of black voter registration over time. What are the things that sort of explain it that might be related to changes in black voter registration? I'm gonna talk to you about a few. I mean, obviously, the Civil War, the 15th Amendment was the beginning, right? And the enforcement of the 15th Amendment within the southern states and getting blacks to register to vote. In this, for example, in Louisiana, black voter registration was basically equal to that of white voter registration during Reconstruction, the Reconstruction era. Upwards of 80% black voter registration is what we found. Now, these are from official state records. There can be some questions about the quality of said records, but we could talk about that. Some of them were quality as in we could hardly read them. We can talk about that. But in the late 1890s, when many of the southern states rewrote their constitutions to enact things like the Grandfather Clause, and poll taxes that effectively disenfranchised, so black voters. I mean, black voter registration went from basically 80% in 1898 to the early 1900s to nearly 0%, and 0% in some parishes. But interestingly, there was still, even despite some of these restrictions, there were still some variation. There were still some blacks registered to vote. Who are these people, right? And so we're in the process of trying to figure some of this out. Some of this may involve a little bit more sort of digging. Some of it involves these certain parishes in Louisiana, parishes or counties, that didn't enforce the law in the same way. And so it essentially went down to zero and stayed that way until the 1940s. And it was just mentioned, they began in the 1940s, and we're trying to figure out some of this. Some of this is related to the easing of some of these restrictions, like the getting rid of the poll tax in Louisiana and the white primaries, right? These things led to sort of blacks actually registering to vote. So as myths go, right, it's often, when I teach American government, students are like, there was not a single black person in the South registered to vote. They all have this sense, right, that no black people were registered to vote. Yeah, well, that's not true. There were black people registered to vote. It's just there weren't many, right? But what we're trying to do is try to understand if there's something systematic to the places that had more or less black people registered to vote. There are some things. And Louisiana is a unique case in some ways because they have this understanding clause that, like other states, but they never enforced it because they didn't have to. And then in the 1950s, when they realized blacks were registered to vote, some parishes decided they were going to enforce it. They had an understanding clause on top of a literacy clause. And so some parishes decided they were going to enforce this thing, and you can see a kind of halting of the black voter registration in response to this, or at least we think. A lot of this involves some sort of more complicated sort of analysis of the data to sort of get a better sense of whether there's some sort of causal relationship between these things. So we're in the process of doing that right now. The interesting point about all of this data is it ranges from 1878 to 2010, and only in 2010 when our data stopped, when we stopped, was the first year that black and white registration in the state of Louisiana were equal, were the same as they were during Reconstruction. And at the same rate, in fact, at about 80-something percent, a little over 80% registration rates for both blacks and whites. But I could talk a lot more about the sort of dynamics of black voter registration in the South, in Louisiana and in the South, but I'm going to turn it over so we can talk a little more.
Okay. And we've talked a lot, and I think we tend to default to a black white binary, and so I want to go back to one of the tropes and sort of think about how do we bring brown people into this discussion. I think we've seen it a couple, one in this discussion or this description of anchor babies, mm-hmm. and even listening to President Trump talk about the reason he didn't win the popular vote is that all of these undocumented persons voted against him. So I'm trying to get an understanding or see if we can discuss, to gain an understanding of how birthright citizenship is understood in the 14th Amendment provides context for our understanding of the 15th Amendment with who votes, who gets to vote, and why. So, Professor Galbraith.
I am not sure I have an answer to that question.
Okay.
I want to say, first of all, that I was a political organizer long before I became an economist. And so okay. I'm really speaking here in that capacity. And I wanted to begin by asking a question which jumps over the 14th Amendment, but relates the other two. And it's possibly a naive question to ask on a panel with a law professor on board, but I posed it to two people earlier today, and I wasn't thrown out of court immediately by them, so I'll try it.
You flipped the script on me, as you said.
That is, the 13th Amendment states that neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime, whereof the party shall have been duly convicted shall exist within the United States. And we heard yesterday a very powerful case that that was effectively a loophole, which has been exploited through mass incarceration to create, in effect, a renewed condition of involuntary servitude for a large part of the American population. And that was done as a political act for the purposes of societal and political control. And if that case is persuasive, then it just seemed to me, it occurred to me, that one reads the 15th Amendment, which states that the right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude, that the 15th Amendment makes out a case for making felony disenfranchisement prima facie unconstitutional. I'm not sure. I see some nods. I'm glad. Maybe I've got the beginning of a legal theory here. Mayor, I can imagine the counter arguments, but it's something on which you only need 5 votes. So it's something which I just throw out there as a possibility. I was very taken by the previous presentations, and I would like to propose that those of us who are in the social sciences think in terms of the urgency of additional studies to the ones that you were just describing. And I had 3 that I wanted to, I think actually Professor Brown-Dean already alluded to one, but 3 that I would suggest could be projects that would be extremely useful for academics in this area to undertake. First of all, we urgently need full and careful documentation of the effect of voter ID laws in Wisconsin, Michigan, Texas, North Carolina on turnout and voting in the last election. It would be, I think, very useful to have a careful documentation so far as it's possible of the effect of the mass foreclosures that occurred in Florida, Ohio, and elsewhere on African-American and Latino communities and their ability to maintain a voting presence. I think this would be, since many of those foreclosures were illegal and carried out in defiance of appropriate legal procedure, I think that is an important element of what has happened to the voting balance in a number of states. I would like to see an inventory at the level of counties, if not congressional districts, it's much more difficult, of the effect of prison population on apportionment for the purposes of representation in state legislatures and in the U.S. House of Representatives. It could be a project that could be distributed over a network of public policy schools, each looking at their own areas. Something has to be approached with a good deal of attention to detail. And as a broader exercise, it seems to me it would be useful just to think about the long-term effects of the kind of social conditions that have prevailed in this country, to do a demographic modeling exercise, state by state, and to ask the question, suppose that African-American citizens had the same life expectancy as white citizens. How many more of them would there have been at each election since the Voting Rights Act was passed? How many more voters, therefore, and what would the effect have been on the outcome of those elections and therefore on the distribution of votes in the Electoral College? Would any of the Republican presidents who have been elected since 1968 have succeeded under those conditions? I think it's at least an open and interesting question that should be addressed. I had a student who attempted to do it some years ago, and I was provoked by it, but I've never gotten to closure. I do think that gerrymandering needs to be addressed in this context, because we have here something which is maybe a bit sensitive, but the fact is that if you place all of the minority voters into a single district, you're creating the conditions under which the House as a whole will be permanently controlled by the other party, so that's by the party for which they do not tend to vote. So that is something which needs to be considered by the community to arrive at some strategy which meets the dual objectives of representation and effective government, and I think that's something that we have not effectively done. But even if all the issues of eligibility and registration and residency and gerrymandering were resolved, there still is the question, which again was raised earlier in this panel, of election administration. And it will still be possible for the local administrators to control the outcome of the election. My last experience with this was in Franklin County in Columbus, Ohio in 2004 when I was helping a friend arrange the motor voter, the get the voter to the polls operation, and I eventually gave up because when you're voters have to wait 3 hours in line. Your get out the vote operation is just wrecked. You can't leave an elderly voter at a polling station to go get someone else. They'll be stranded there. I then went and took a voter, as it happened, a 19-year-old African-American teenage girl, to the polls and waited for 3 hours while she stood in the pouring rain to vote. Recognized that in that particular situation, we had three precincts in a single voting station, and the administrators had done the very simple thing of having them all share the same line. So matter whether you had a lot or a few voters for your particular precinct, you still had to wait for the 3 hours required to get everybody through to the 6 voting machines, which have been allocated, all of the new ones having gone out to the suburbs or the districts that didn't have African-American or student voters to it. That kind of thing is, I think, a problem which operates at such a level of detail that it suggests to me that there needs to be a kind of comprehensive solution. And so I'll close with a policy recommendation, which I made at the time and I continue to believe to be the right one, which is that we simply abolish Election Day. Get rid of it altogether. This has been done in the state of Oregon, which I will say a word in the defense of its reputation, at least on this point, seems to have come to the right solution, with universal vote by mail. With a signature check, basically, you write your name on the back of the ballot with the ballot closed inside. Creates a paper trail. It creates essentially a randomized counting mechanism, which can be done by machine, but which is verifiable. There is essentially no fraud. But there's also no exit polling, no long evening of counting that with the potential for distorting the outcome by holding back precincts that you might be able to manipulate. It's a clean system which generates a high level of voter participation and takes the problem of, or at least the power of vote suppression out of the hands that are most likely to use it in subtle ways that are extremely hard for lawyers or even political activists to counteract on the spot, which is to say the corruption of local election administration in this country. Thank you.
So you guys have been given a charge. I know we have a number of students, so there may be dissertation research and other opportunities there. Checking the clock, it looks like our day is running short, but I did want to open up for questions.
We all could talk more, I'm sure.
And I did want to provide opportunities to talk, but I did want to make sure. And what's happened a couple times is we haven't had questions, and if we don't, then it opens up the time for. And I think we have a couple questions.
Come back to it, since you, it seems to me that the issue you raised to me, which would had to do with birthright citizenship, and the has at least one fairly straightforward aspect, which is that we are creating a new apartheid society by having a large number of undocumented people who work in this country who do not have a path to become citizens, voting citizens. That's a substantial element of the working population who have no voice in the way in which the society is run. And you can think about it, the blessing of the 14th Amendment is that their children will in fact be citizens, so it's only an 18-year period before there is an element of representation. And the issue is, do you do anything for the people who are here permanently, who are living amongst us, and who are in almost exactly the same legal position the African-American population was in before the Voting Rights Act? Zero capacity to register or to vote. And my answer to that would be, of course, there's no question in my mind that this is an issue which simply has to do is being contested for reasons of political control, not, I think, for any other legitimate purpose.
Just very briefly, one of the differences, though, is that if we look at the African-American population, they did have the formal right to vote, and the first pieces of congressional voting rights enforcement legislation were two acts called the 1870 Enforcement Act and the Ku Klux Klan Act of 1871. And the federal government actually suppressed the Klan in 1871 in South Carolina for voting rights. And so we have actually a partial record during Reconstruction of federal actions to protect the black vote, yet that's been obscured by bad history. And so part of what has to be part of the solution is getting better history about actually what Congress tried to do and the mechanisms that suppressed the black vote in the wake of the 15th Amendment, and that was primarily violence. I mean, violence is unpunished violence is what allowed for the suppression of the black vote. Unpunished violence is what permitted disenfranchisement in 1890. And so to get better history on the books about what led to disenfranchisement, I think is part of it's part of the kinds of policy prescriptions that you're putting on the table.
I'd like to hear some reactions to Jamie's inference that the 15th Amendment provides a blockade against the exclusion of ex-felons from voting.
And I didn't get to answer that question. And I think we actually run into the language is not as good in the 15th Amendment because it says shall not be denied or abridged by any state on account of race, and which is actually limiting language. And because the state is given the benefit of the doubt, you'd have to prove intent on the part of the state to show that it was race-based.
But it says, or involuntary.
Prison is not considered involuntary servitude.
Ah, but we were making the argument yesterday that that's precisely what the loophole of the 13th Amendment was.
But that allowed for prison.
I understand the counter argument.
The state would still say that it wasn't, in fact, involuntary servitude. Right. It was the due process that happened upon the conviction, whether or not you had to serve the time or not. And that is the same whether or not you got a felony and didn't have to serve any time, or whether or not you had the felony and did have to serve time.
And it's also a challenge back to the original point about not having an affirmative right to vote. Mm-hmm. Because when people have raised this case and tried to use the language of the 15th and the Voting Rights Act to say, look, this may not be intent, but it has a disparate impact, and this is why. In a state like Iowa, which, no offense to anyone from Iowa, does not strike me as being particularly racially and ethnically diverse, but has had these disparate impacts, the court has said, barring having that affirmative right to vote, you can't say that you are entitled to that. And I think it makes it even more complicated because we have every state and DC deciding for themselves what the conditions or qualifications should be for voting. So you can be in my home state of Virginia and have a felony and not be able to vote, but that does not preclude you from holding public office. So you can be a Joe Morrissey in jail for corruption of a minor, still be an elected official, run for public office again, not be able to vote in that election, but be eligible to hold it. So those kinds of inconsistencies, I think, are what turns off a lot of people. It's why we get the myths, why we get the bad history, and why we don't think, I heard your point earlier about the binary, of looking at how Native communities have been affected by these very same things and not having that same level of recognition of the ways that certain behaviors become criminalized as an excuse to have these collateral consequences, then we get the same kind of outcomes.
I'm actually interested in a potential comparison between Louisiana, like the rate of voting between Louisiana and these other states, because I think like one of the other ways that Louisiana is unique is it's got like a civil law system as opposed to a common law system, which makes me wonder what does the kind of legal order that we imagine certain states to have play a role in terms of the enforcement of certain voting rights acts, mm-hmm. or certain, like voting rights. Yeah.
That's a good question. I don't know anything about Louisiana law, other than
we're political scientists.
Yeah, but I can imagine that, you know, the sort of culture of the state is a little bit different given all of that and the sort of French influence. I mean, so one of the things is that the least restrictive places in the state were the places where the French had settled. So the southern part of the state. I mean, today they're just all white people now, but back
it's
then they were.
Haitians, it's not the French.
What's that? Oh,
it's Haitians.
It's a mix. It's a mix. So there's Cajuns, there are people from France through Haiti, right, that people like to claim.
And you have a different racial group with folks
blacks
who
are different,
as Creole.
Right? Yeah, and blacks are very different from the whites there. So it's just literally just a mix of people, right, of French descent, right? And so it was a little different, right, in terms of how restrictive they were, those particular parishes were, but over time they've become basically all the same.
The other thing I was add, I don't know the numbers here, but Louisiana had a fairly high number of black legislators,
yes.
State elected during Reconstruction. Mm-hmm.
And they had a lieutenant governor who became governor, right? After the governor died.
So historically, we'd have to look at the number of black legislators elected and if they were in part responsible for getting these laws on the books. Of course, those laws could have been repealed later on.
But that
might be a factor.
That's right.
So I want to thank you guys. We're running out of time, and I've been told to keep everything on time. I believe the bus is supposed to be here in about 3 minutes.
Oh,
but I want to thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
Very fast.
That was a good panel.